planet Internet. Self-appointed scientists are filming outrageous acts of science. These Internet heroes are doing bizarre experiments, making extraordinary inventions, and creating amazing scientific stunts. We gathered a team of top science brains to analyze just how they do it, why they do it, and choose the very best. It's science, but not as you know it. So stand back and don't even think about trying this at all. No, seriously. In this show, we'll be counting down the top 20 epic stunts by those daredevils who love to put on a show in the name of science.
To be in our top 20 epic stunts, what I'm looking for, first of all, is a stunt. And that stunt should be big, it should be crazy, and it should make things happen that I've never seen before.
Impress us, make us gasp, and it has to be ingenious.
For me, they always have to be about pushing the boundaries, going to the limits, to actually see how much people just put their faith in science.
So now that we know what it takes to get in our countdown, let the stunts begin. At number 20. The ascent of Mount Epic begins in the sleepy Welsh village of Llandilo, where four 16-year-olds, Rhys, Jack, Kai, and Ifan, have developed an unhealthy obsession with nettles, the famous weed that stings like a bee. This fearless crew designed a stunt that proves you don't have to be crazy to do science, but it sure helps.
We ask you humbly not to try this at home.
After his brush with the stinging shrubbery, Ivan's pain was on display for all to see. But like any good scientist, he's willing to share the results of his experiment.
It felt like, at the start, I thought I could hold it in, and then more pain eventually came because I was hitting more nettles, and eventually I just ran across the field screaming. It lasted about 3 days solid. It wasn't as much pain for that 3 days. It was just this constant, irritating and annoying itch.
Watching that made me hurt. I hurt for Ifan.
This is what the stinging nettles did.
So how did Ifan's encounter with the kings of sting lead to a world of well-based agony?
The reason that nettles can sting so quickly is because they've evolved this really clever defense mechanism. They're covered in these tiny silica hairs, which when you look in close at them, are actually kind of like needles with a little glass bobble on the top of them. Now, when you brush next to these nettles, you end up knocking the top off of these hairs, and you're left with a sharp glass shard, which is a lot like a hypodermic syringe. And this syringe is filled with lots of nasty chemicals, which it can then just pump straight into your skin.
There are a few different toxins which get injected into the body. One, which is quite interesting, is histamine, which causes the inflammation.
You also have serotonin, and that ends up firing off all of his pain receptors up to his brain. It ends up tricking him into thinking that something's actually attacking his skin.
Which is the perfect deterrent from grazing animals and from Welsh kids rolling in you.
Basing your stunt around braving chemical reactions is one thing, but this next epic stunt shows how the laws of physics can surprise us in equally epic proportions.
Karachi number one bike rider is crazy.
Meet 20-year-old Zayab Khan from Karachi, Pakistan. He'd been riding motorcycles for just 2 years before he started filming sweet moves like this. And this. And this. From these videos, it's clear that what our Karachi Knievel has instinctively learned is that the need for speed is his bike's best friend.
If you go really fast, that steering column's going to want to go straight forward. If your speed drops too low, though, and you hit a bump or some kind of perturbation in the road, that wheel's going to turn. And if it turns too much, it's going to turn all the way. And that bike's going to flip over and he's going to tumble off the back of his bike.
The faster he goes, the more stable the bike becomes. But regardless of speed, these stunts are insanely dangerous and made even worse by not wearing a helmet.
I would never advise anybody to ride a motorcycle normally without a helmet, let alone stand on the back of it without a helmet, on the middle of a street, going at speed, surrounded by other people on motorbikes. It's a terrible idea. Don't do it.
It's nighttime in the warm, nutrient-rich waters of Southern California. And 20-year-old surfer Joe Puckett has gone for a midnight surf. No, your eyes aren't deceiving you. That blue light is actually coming from the wave itself. Joel has been kind enough to illuminate us with his scientific surfing.
It is a beautiful clip. There is quite an ethereal quality, the fact that anywhere his board goes, it seems to flash blue.
It's weird and amazing, and you're just sort of like, whoa, what's going on there?
Good question. What is causing the eerie light show?
What we're seeing here are billions and billions of tiny single-celled organisms called dinoflagellates. And when they're agitated, as they are as the surfboard moves through the wave, they are shaken, stirred around, and it gives off this blue light that we see.
This is something that biologists have coined the burglar alarm hypothesis. When these guys are disturbed or threatened, they flash because if some kind of predator is coming after them, what they're going to do is flash and say, hey, predators of the predator, they're over here.
So what we're seeing then is a crazy kind of single-cell aquatic neighborhood watch as billions of these little fellows flash together. It's called bioluminescence.
I've seen surfing before, like, fine, but this is better than surfing. This is surfing the light fantastic.
As our countdown continues, we're always on the lookout for increasingly imaginative ways that epic stunts can conjure science. And number 17 is an example that's guaranteed to stick with you. One fine day, Californian Jeff Dull was riding in the back of his buddy's motorcycle when he wanted a shake. Perfect opportunity for an epic stunt.
I don't see how this could have gone any differently. I think that's exactly what he had in mind when he got on the back of that motorbike.
Jeff wanted to see if he could drink the shake while accelerating to 100 miles per hour. And I think that proves it. The answer is absolutely not.
Put yourself in his place. You're on the motorbike, you've got your milkshake, you're accelerating forwards. And what's happening is the milkshake's coming with you because it's in a cup, it's being forced forwards with you. But the fatal flaw is when he tips the milkshake towards his face. At that point, there's no force pushing the milkshake along with them at the same speed. So he tips it to take a drink. The milkshake would rather be staying where it was a moment ago, and that's what it tries to do.
So Jeff's endeavor was physically impossible, leaving him with some significant cleanup. But there's another concern.
And then he's littering. He's throwing that thing away. He's probably going to get a fine. There's videotape evidence of him littering.
Thanks to Jeff's shake science, we now know the results will always be the same. But sometimes epic stunts make the top 20 when there are unforeseen consequences. Meet Estonian fireman Ivar Francisov, an expert in the bespoke sport of kayaking. That's looping on a swing to you and me. And there's no doubt that Ivar tapped into his inner child. But for some, dreams quickly become nightmares. And that's exactly what happened when Latvian Edgar Leipinj attempted his very own home version of kayaking.
So he's just screaming, ah! As any of us would be. And so you gotta wonder, right? Did he lose a bet? What's the story here?
Correct. Edgar did do this for a bet, which he lost. But what science has gone wrong between Ivar's epic win and Edgar's epic fail? Remember, that's Ivar's epic win and Edgar's epic fail.
With a little help from his friends, he quickly gathers a fair degree of angular momentum as he's flying around the outside of the swing there. And then there's two forces at work. The centrifugal force is willing him to fly out. But centripetal force, which is the swing holding him back, is equaling that in the opposite direction. Therefore, he stays true to the orbit. His problem starts when he probably loses a little bit of grip or shifts his weight. So suddenly there's a misbalance there. And those two forces, the centrifugal and the centripetal, suddenly the centrifugal beats it. And it doesn't just beat it a little bit, it hammers it.
Edgar may have lost his grip on the swing, but he'll forever be a part of an epic stunt. Well done, sir. Well done. So far, the stunts have undoubtedly been epic. We've seen glowing dinoflagellates, velocity saving a stuntman from certain death, and the inertia of milkshakes. But hey, we're only at number 16. So stay with us as we continue our summit of Mount Epic on Outrageous Acts of Science. Welcome back to our countdown of science's most epic stunts. So far, we've seen the defense system of nettles and the dangers of researching circular motion. But as we hurtle into our top 15, we find epic stunts that push the boundaries of what's possible.
You know, we always used to think that when we were kids, if you held enough balloons, it would pull you in the air. So now, apparently, it's real.
Yes, it works, all right. And here's the proof. What you see is a man hanging from 1,200 party balloons floating above the Jenswalde power plant in Germany. So, who's responsible for this balloon-based buoyancy? Well, it's this man, British commercial air pilot Mike Holland.
To actually see him underneath a cluster balloon, like clusters of balloons, I mean, this is a man who's really living his math. So I'm very impressed.
Yes, Mike needs a head for figures as well as height. So what prep is involved in getting this world record holding balloonist to a height of almost 4,000 feet?
The preparation starts deciding how high you want to go. Then you need to determine the weight you're going to be lifting, because that determines how many balloons you need and how much helium you need. We needed just under 1,200 balloons to do the flight.
So what's Mike relying on to make sure this epic stunt doesn't go down with a bang?
You need to get to the point where the volume of air that the balloon displaces weighs more than the helium in the balloon. As the air is being displaced, it naturally goes underneath the balloon because it's heavier than the balloon. So it's essentially being pushed up by the air it's being displaced. But then you've got to take into account the weight of him, the weight of the chair, all the apparatus.
Mike just needs enough balloons to create a buoyant force big enough to overpower the weight of him and his rig. But hang on. If helium is lighter than air, then what keeps Mike from ending up in space?
On the ground, the helium balloon appears really light compared to the dense air. So the helium balloon has lift. As we go up in altitude, that difference becomes less and less. So there comes a point when the weight of the helium balloon is equal to an equivalent volume of air, and therefore he has no lift anymore. So there'll come a point when it perfectly balances, and rather than flying off into space and being captured by aliens and all the terrible things that could happen to Mike if he's not careful, he will level out and just sort of bounce nicely along.
And what space-age technology gets Mike back to planet Earth?
The only way to come down is to pop some of the balloons. So I had an air pistol in one hand and a knife on a long stick on the other, and when I wanted to come down, I'd pop a balloon.
So Mike's two-hour-long epic stunt was a result of precision planning, knowledge of helium, and a knife on a stick. But sometimes our experts love it when epic science is more spontaneous. This bunch of Spanish amigos were having fun at an abandoned mine when they found an old tractor tire. So what happened next? Well, an epic stunt, of course. Their bold and bouncy experiments became a bona fide internet smash that caught our experts' eyes.
I was watching, and the first jump was like, oh, wow. Wow! Wow! It's going so high!
So what's behind this tire's unbelievably bouncy descent?
The reason that this tire bounces so high is because the vulcanized rubber is really good at storing energy. Now what happens is you've got, on a molecular level, lots of long polymer chains, and these chains will either be forced together in areas of compression or stretched out in areas of tension. These molecules don't really like this, and they'd much rather get back to the way things were. So what happens is they go back to their original state, releasing the energy they stored, and that all contributes to a bigger bounce.
But if you've got a spare tire at home, think again. Sending a bouncing tire down a hill is a really, really dangerous thing to do. So please don't try this at home. As our countdown continues, things can only get more epic. This is footage of an anonymous Norwegian known only as Arild. It shows him about to descend the up escalator of a London metro station. What's so epic about that, you ask? Well, he's doing it on skis. What you're seeing is epic and incredibly dangerous. But it also begs the question, how can you ski downstairs?
Now, the stairs need to be close enough so there's always at least three of them under the skis.
If you had only one step, the edge of that step would act as a pivot point, and the ski would actually get rotating around that axis.
So he needs to make sure
his center of mass on the skis, he's got at least one stair on either side of that.
So at all times, it's constantly having contact with each one of these pivot points sliding down the escalator.
And that's how we ski down an escalator, which of course is highly illegal, and you should never try it yourself. Stick around for more epic stunts on Outrageous Acts of Science. Welcome back. In at number 12. In the south of England, 37-year-old sailor Alex Thompson created this breathtaking entry into the pantheon of epic stunts. But setting aside Alex's bravery and the undoubted skill of the boat skipper, what really got her experts going was this. The engineering triumph that is the keel.
The keel is a very ingenious invention, right? It basically makes the boat uncapsizable. So normally it's under the water doing this job, but now it's being raised out of the water, and what you expect to happen is for the boat to capsize, but it doesn't.
So how has Alex created this seawater seesaw? With the weight of the sail and the mast in one direction, and the weight of the keel in the other direction.
This isn't an everyday normal boat you see here. This boat has something called a variable keel in it, which means they can adjust the angle of the keel relative to the boat. So now, you can see here, they're tipping over the boat, it's listing, and they're ratcheting up the keel. So now, the keel's actually coming out of the water, exposing it so that he can do his keel walk.
For not letting your stunts keel over, Alex, we salute you. For some people, the playground isn't a place for an epic stunt. But when these gyroscopic Germans attached their scooter to a merry-go-round, they came away with a head rush they weren't expecting.
They stumble around. They literally can't stand up. And I don't know why, but humans find it funny when other humans fall.
Yes, we do. But how does putting your head in a super spin cycle like this make you wash out?
Balance is controlled by something called the semicircular canals in your ear. And these are three different tubes, basically pointed in X, Y, and Z axes. And each of these tubes is filled with a fluid, a very thick fluid. When the fluid moves within the tube, it actually pushes the different hair-like nerve cells in the tube in different directions. And that sends signals to your brain telling you that you're moving in a certain direction. And so when you get off the carousel, those nerve cells are all still pointed in the direction where they were pointed before. They tell you that you're still going around in a circle, but your eyes see that you're not moving. So there's a conflict there, and that's what causes dizziness.
Epic stunts are all about rewriting the rule book. You could be the first to have tried something. The guy who rewrites the book. Or you could just book yourself a trip to the hospital. But for these next folks, their stunt changed their lives forever.
I was a trial lawyer. I had a very nice career, and Fritz had a fabulous career as one of the world's best jugglers. He's a 5-time gold medal winning juggler. And then we put a video online,
and that ruined both of our careers.
Meet Fritz and Steve, who pioneered the mixing of cola and candy technology. Now, 10 million people have checked out their online annex, but it was this particular stunt that had our experts acting like kids in a candy shop. Behold, the world's first Coke and Mentos-powered car launch. But how is a mere mint unleashing such awesome power?
We all like soda, and one of the reasons is there's all these little bubbles in it. And these Mentos have all these little craters. You know, they look smooth, but they're not.
And that's ideal for forming bubbles. As the Mento gets put into the bottle, it starts off forming some bubbles at the top, but it's very heavy, so it falls down really quickly, making bubbles along the way. And all the bubbles from the bottom come up and start forming more bubbles. And then these bubbles create more bubbles, which create more bubbles, which create the amazing plumes that you get from Coke and Mento.
You might think that when you drop some Mentos and some soda, that what it's doing is creating all these bubbles. The reality is, it's just releasing all the bubbles that are already within the soda.
Awesome. But what's truly earned these bubbly boys the number 10 spot in our countdown is how they power their epic dragster.
For our car, every bottle is hooked up to a tube that has a piston inside it. So when the spray comes up, it comes in the tube and pushes the piston out. And that pushes against the wall at the back. And pretty much all of the power of the soda's harnessed. And then we have 100 plus of those, and that suits the car.
A genius piece of cola-based engineering. So wait a minute. Are we looking at the answer to the world's energy crisis here?
If the trip you're making is only, you know, a few hundred feet, this is the way to go.
How far did the Wright brothers go the first time?
Exactly.
So far, we've seen how the semicircular canals in your ear can make you eat dirt. And how clever engineering allowed a sharp-dressed man to do this. But after the break, we get even closer to the ultimate epic stunt. So far in our worldwide hunt for epic stunts, we found out how Fizz can drive a car and explore the chemical warfare of weeds. But as we continue the countdown, our experts are looking for stunts that really ramp things up. Like this next clip that's had 12 million online hits. No, it's not a close-up of a child's toy. It's a massive car jump from really far away. Stunt driver Tanner Faust and his team took a year to build this epic stunt for a quarter of a million people at the Indianapolis racetrack.
When I was a kid, I played with these cars and tracks all the time. And when I saw this track and the fact that it was the same orange track with the same side rails and the car looked like the little cars I played with, that was pretty awesome for me.
Here we go in 4, 3, 2, 1.
From a height of 10 stories, the car accelerated to 90 miles per hour, hit the 16-foot ramp, and flew over a world record-breaking 330 feet.
And just the thought of flying at that speed and landing with that maneuvering there, oh my God, it's awesome.
I think it's amazing. Whenever I did this, the toy cars never ended well. I think that that's the thing that they've done really cleverly here, is that they can still use the car afterwards.
Yes, the car landed in one piece and lived to jump another day. But what super science did they do to pull off this epic stunt?
The car is undergoing what we call projectile motion, right? So once it leaves the track, we can predict the path with a high degree of accuracy.
Jumping off is easy. It's landing that's the hard part. So while the car is in motion on air, the only force acting on it is gravity and a little bit of drag from the wind.
You don't want it to land too soon. You don't want it to go too far. And so I want to make sure that it misses the front, but does not miss the end. And so that designs my ramp over here and my ramp upon which I land.
So all the driver has to do is concentrate on his steering and make sure he doesn't veer off the ramp as he's going down.
So top marks for Tanner and his truly epic stunt. However, in his bid for glory, he and his team did have the law of physics on their side, which helps a lot. Moving on to number 8, a man who creates science with his heart, mind, and enormous lungs. Meet Austrian Herbert Nitsch, an expert in the extreme sport of freediving, which basically involves taking one huge breath, diving as deep as you can, and coming back to the surface alive. But Herbert never intended to become one of the world's greatest freedivers.
I was on a scuba diving safari in Egypt when the airline lost all my diving luggage, and therefore I was forced to do snorkeling. And shortly after, I was going deeper and longer, and this is how I started freediving.
But it was this amazing 390-foot world record free dive on April 2010 at the Dean Blue Hole in the Bahamas that had our experts gasping for air. Yes, almost 400 feet. That's deeper than 1.5 jumbo jets placed end to end.
This guy holds his breath for 4.5 minutes, goes 120 meters down, 120 meters back up. That's very abusive to the body. I'm impressed with this guy.
Considering that the average person can only hold their breath for about a minute on land before gasping for air, this becomes quite a feat. But underwater, Herbert is exploiting something that exists in us all. The mammalian diving reflex.
Your body has a diving reflex. You know, it kind of slows down your heart rate, restricts the blood supply to your extremities, the parts that are not vital for survival. Also, your spleen is triggered to release a lot of blood cells to supply the blood.
So in addition to his body instinctively trying to make the most of its stored oxygen, Herbert has a few tricks of his own.
You can see him doing that series of breaths right before he dives, and that's actually called lung packing. It's a technique that divers use to be able to hold more air in their lungs right before they go down. It has to do with pushing the oxygen down into the lungs using the muscles of the throat. He wants to pack his lungs and his body with as much oxygen as they can hold before he goes down there.
Beyond his super lungs, Herbert has another weapon in his war against the deep. And he keeps it in his head.
When I go deep, I'm focused on the essential parts of the dive. I'm trying to reduce the workload as much as possible, so my mind is as free and as relaxed as it could be.
But while our scientists marvel at this achievement, Herbert is just happy to be above water again and in possession of a new world record.
What's he doing to his son?
Our next epic stunt came from Les Buddy, Texas, where Elmer De Palmer joined his son and nephew in some electrifying family bonding.
Very natural when you see an electric fence to stay away from it.
You are crazy.
She's right, Elmer. You are crazy. Touching an electric fence really, really hurts.
It's a bit like wet paint, do not touch. You think,
what, is it?
No, it is, yeah, you're absolutely right.
Yes, this is a stupid thing to do, but Elmer may be more clever than he looks. He's turned an electric fence into group shock therapy.
So overall, it's quite low power. You're not going to kill anyone, but you will cause a jar.
What these people have done is they've created a resistor ladder. So the dad pours the fence, and the current flows through his hand. It splits. Some of it goes to ground, and some of it goes to his son. Then some of his current goes to ground, and some of it goes to his brother. So each person down the chain gets a lower and lower current.
That theory is confirmed when you look at the reaction of the family after they had their bolt, because the dad, he keels over, suggesting that he's had the biggest whack.
Okay, stick around for more outrageous acts of science. Sometimes an epic stunt deserves an epic backdrop. So welcome to Lake Paradise, Utah, and a promotional film for a clothing company which has gone viral. But our experts don't care about fashion, they care about epic science. Like a human slingshot.
Come on, man, to be like a late teen, early 20s again, we'd all love to do that.
Okay, it is fun, but our experts have to look beyond mere frivolity. Hitting heights of more than 30 feet, these magnificent flying men have been slung distances of up to 120 feet.
Now, to launch someone that far is going to take a lot of energy because you've got to apply a very big force to them.
By adding something extra, and that thing is a bungee cord, stretching across the lake.
They're gradually storing potential energy in a giant bit of elastic. So they got a quad bike, which is pulling and pulling and pulling and putting more and more energy into this one giant bit of elastic. And then they release it all at once, and it's transferred straight to some poor chump sitting on an inflatable raft, and off he goes.
In fact, the human slingshot was so good, they kept it up late into the night. For stunt stamina alone, human slingshotters, you are epic. So far, we've had some great stunts. But to be in our top five, our experts want to be dazzled by spectacular displays that reveal truly epic science.
Now, I've been fishing since I was a kid, and it's a long, boring process of waiting and hard work. And now I see, apparently, if you go to the right place, the fish will just jump in the boat for you.
On a small fork in the River Spoon, West Illinois, Mother Nature offers an odd epic stunt, courtesy of the Asian carp, as provoked by boat driver John.
Definitely the most bizarre fish clip I've ever seen, the Asian carp. They are startled by the noise of the boat, by the motor, and they're in quite a narrow channel, and there's not a lot of room for them to swim away. So their instinct is to leap out away from what they think is a predator and jump out into great heights in the air.
Now, this may seem fun in the video, but jumping carps have inflicted a host of injuries, ranging from broken jaws, noses, and even spines. So be careful.
These are pretty big fish, so I wouldn't really want to be on that boat. They're whopping fish. They can get up to 7 feet. If they collide with people while they're going about 30 miles an hour, there have been some quite serious injuries from them.
this looks extremely cool. I would love to fly one of these.
Hey, who hasn't dreamed of having their very own jetpack? Now, most give up when their homemade attempts fail to take off. But not Glenn Martin and his team of engineers and pilots, who have dedicated themselves to turning fantasy into reality. After comprehensive testing, Glenn sent his Martin jetpack over 3,000 feet into the sky for an epic 9-minute flight. The challenges of jetpack design are massive. Previous attempts have used rockets for propulsion, and this causes huge problems due to the weight of the fuel.
By the time you've got enough fuel to lift the human, and you've got enough fuel to lift the fuel, and the fuel to lift that fuel, the whole thing weighs a huge amount, and you get, what, 30 seconds in the air.
So what did Glenn do with his jetpack that makes it better than the rocket men of years past?
To get something like this to work, you need to make a very nice, lightweight, composite, fan-based system. And he's using that to fly around sort of like a helicopter. The fans spin at a huge velocity, and the air molecules just push down against other air molecules, creating enough thrust to make the guy fly higher and higher.
If we didn't have these people driving forward and pushing and seeing what can be done, then we'll never get the amazing jetpacks, which we, fingers crossed, will get one day.
So far, epic stunts have shown us the projectile motion of a scaled-up toy car and the potential energy in a piece of elastic rope. But after the break, the top three epic stunts on Outrageous Acts of Science. Welcome back. So far, our epic stunts have demonstrated the inbuilt defense system of startled carp and how the velocity of rotor blades helps the ascent of man. But as we approach the very apex of Mount Epic, things begin to get scary.
I love this video so much. It shows such amazing engineering. And if it was up to me alone, this video would be number one. But I got to deal with those other guys, and we voted on it. This one's number three.
That is genuinely the scariest thing I have ever seen. Is that real? And when are they coming for me? Almost looks like when in movies you see aliens coming down to Earth to dominate the planet.
Yes, our number three epic stunt comes courtesy of the GRASP Lab at the University of Pennsylvania, where some clever people have unleashed this. An army of highly mobile, seemingly intelligent robot creatures called nanoquadrotors.
I have to say, on a slightly pernickety level, they're not actually nanoquadrotors. For things to be actually nanotechnology, they have to be on the nanometer scale. Nanometers are a billionth of a meter, and these are a bit larger than that. That said, they are still really, really cool.
This internet smash has our experts salivating on oh so many levels. Take first the individual.
Quadrotors have four propellers that are pulling it up, and you can control the speed of each of these. And so when you make two on one side go faster, it pulls that side up more, which pulls it off in that direction, or vice versa. And that's how you can flip it and turn it and control it. The other thing is, the whole thing isn't rotating around. The reason it's not rotating around is because they rotate two of them in opposite directions. So this causes kind of counter-rotational force. Very clever, very smart.
So that's what makes the nanoquadrotor capable of agile flight. But how can a swarm of them do this? Or this?
One computer is directing the movements of each of these robots, and it's functioning like the conductor in a symphony, telling each robot where to go. The room is outfitted with cameras, and the cameras are tracking the positions of the robots at very high speed and very precisely. So this computer is crunching numbers at an incredible rate. It's tracking the positions of the robots in real time, and it's sending commands to the robots at 600 times every second.
And that is what's truly astonishing, how they've made this program to give everything this amazing synchronized effect.
The number two epic stunt starts off east of Moscow, where some people are on the roof of an abandoned building 160 feet above the ground. The lady in question is 23-year-old Viva Marcuti, and her stunt, which is the purest essence of distilled epic. And it had our experts cowering behind the sofa.
This is epically scary.
It looks like fun, man. This will be great.
This may look like a terrible idea, and it is. But as always, our experts are quick to spot some very sound science.
Use a bob on a pendulum. And so a pendulum is usually rigid, and the bob is at the end. And so you can imagine that if she's attached to a rope here and she drops straight down, bad result. But if you take that rope and you make it taut and you let her go, she follows this gentle arc.
Even if you start the swing of a pendulum slightly off, as she was thrown from the side of a building, it will very soon follow the right path. And that means it's actually pretty safe, so tie me up, throw me off a building.
Or maybe not. Our epic banquet of stunts has taken us to the four corners of the World Wide Web, where we've encountered valiant stuntmen and women who have shocked, amazed, and even educated us. But at number one, our experts have selected a man who harnessed the laws of physics to become a living legend, eventually. It's 36-year-old Yuri Wisnowski, the finest stuntman in all of Lithuania. Yuri and his team have been entertaining Lithuanians for 10 years with their death-defying feats. But it's one particular stunt that has sent our experts into a spin and earned him the number one spot.
He's a guy who had a dream, and he made it happen.
Yes, back in 2001, Lithuania had never before witnessed anything quite like this daring escapade. But if you think the stunt was epic, it's nothing compared to the story behind it that saw science fiction turn into science fact.
The idea of the loop came from my dream. I had a dream just like I'm doing loop by car. It was like loop found me, not I find loop.
But for Yurik's dream to come true, he had to embark on an epic journey. First, a trip to the physics department at Lithuanian University.
And I spent 1 year to understand what should I do, which speed I should have, what construction, how big it should be. I spent 1 year. After I understood, I left university.
So with Yurik's crash course complete, he set about constructing his 35-foot in diameter death loop. Such an undertaking would pose problems to any would-be stunt lord.
So, three main conditions. Construction must be strong, stay on the same place, and of course safety. I must be alive.
Obviously, this guy's gotta have balls. Because even someone like myself who's done the math, when the math tells you that you need to approach a loop-the-loop at 100 kilometers per hour, you really have to question, what am I doing?
Throughout the process, Yurik's dream was dismissed by many.
No one supported, no one believed in this project. My mom, she said, you're crazy. It is impossible. Nobody can drive car upside down.
And on his first attempt in front of a crowd of 10,000, things did not go well.
I held my breath when it got to the top. I knew it was gonna fall. There's just no way near fast enough.
When you see him just crashing down, you do think, what was this physics degree? Is it a weekend course?
For many, that would be the end of their dream. But Yuri knew better. He knew that although the laws of science have been responsible for his failure, they could also be responsible for his success.
The pivotal point where you have to do all your calculations is based on the very top. So the force at the very top is where, if you're going to fall, that's where it will happen. So as long as you've covered off the force due to gravity at the very top, you're going to make it around.
You have to counteract gravity. So there needs to be a force pushing up that balances the force pushing down. If he has sufficient speed, then he can generate enough force to stay on. However, if he generates too much force, he can break the structure.
And 1 month and three attempts later, this happened.
People were looking at me and they said, you did it. Loop is possible. Loop by car. Do it again.
everything. Dreamt about it, designed it, thought about it, constructed it, and he's the one that wrote the car and made the loop.
It's absolutely fantastic. He actually drove his car all the way through a loop-de-loop that he built himself.